Thank you. Okay, well, I want to thank my host. Thanks to Professor Gary Cohn. And I'm really sad that Leslie Morris can't be with us. She's been hit very hard with the flu. And I just hope that she's up and around soon. It's terrible to miss her. And again, it's wonderful to be here. I haven't been here very often, but I might have had your children or friends or maybe even some of you in the classroom. That is, I was at the University of Wisconsin for all of the 1980s. And so I was a TA for I don't know how many classes while I was there. And I had probably hundreds of students from Minnesota over the years. Can't even say how many from Minneapolis. So I hope your children or nieces and nephews had a good experience with me, if they remember. If not, I'm sorry. What can we say? But so anyway, I feel very close to the place. Well, before I begin with the main subject for the evening, I want to make some brief remarks about someone who's familiar to everyone here and who's actually played a very large part in my academic work for the last several years. That is Eric Mendelssohn, the architect of your synagogue. Mendelssohn was a German Jewish architect, as most of you know, lived from 1887 to 1953. And in applying expressionist and functionalist ideas to his commissions, and boy, do you see something here, even though he didn't quite live to see it. One of his signature works was the Mossy House. That is the headquarters of the Mossy publishing business in Berlin. So although, of course, this did not exist at the time that I knew my own teacher, George Mossy, and it actually a little part of it has been reconstructed. This is something that was a very large in our imaginations. So again, quite significant. My own teacher, George Mossy, at Wisconsin, of course, was a descendant of the founders of this publishing empire. Actually, Mendelssohn was also related to him. I'm not sure what the exact relationship was, but a lot of these German Jewish families, prominent families, were actually related to each other. They were related to the Warburgs and many others. And I know that George mentioned that Eric Mendelssohn was some kind of distant cousin. So they were in some ways keeping it in the family. Well, my main reason for mentioning him is that he was also a very talented photographer, actually extremely talented photographer. And his photo book of New York was actually one of the first and best of its kind. It was impressive to none other than Franz Kafka, all of you have heard of, in Beaumont Newhall, who's not Jewish, who is one of the foundational historians of photography, also credits Eric Mendelssohn for having sparked his interest in photography. Newhall, who was a New England Yankee aristocrat, although in a lot of ways a very modest guy, developed a love, really a great love, for both the city of New York and photography, which led him to the studio of Alfred Stieglitz. He had actually been directed there by the person who was the head of his program in graduate school at Harvard, that is Paul Sachs. He gave him a list of the people who collected photography and were interested in photography. So this is really an important connection for me. And this was also the path that led Beaumont Newhall to befriend and collaborate with Helmut Gernsheim. Gernsheim is a figure I'll be talking about here in a number of times. I think Gernsheim was by far the most important figure in the history of photography's history. Along with Beaumont Newhall, he really is the person who turned a serious, trained eye to photography and really wanted to discuss it as something beyond optics and chemicals and sort of more narrow concerns that people had had up to this point. So I've had the opportunity to explore Helmut Gernsheim and also his brother in a recent book, as well as in a volume that's edited by my colleague, who unfortunately isn't here, that is Leslie Morris. I've written about Helmut Gernsheim in a book that she edited recently. So in some important respects, I might not be here if not for Eric Mendelsohn. It is, say, one of the reasons why I throw things at students who rely on Wikipedia just to see if it's in there. There is no mention of this aspect of Mendelsohn's career in the entry, so it's something that, say, isn't really all that common, but I think he was really quite distinguished in this area. Well, he doesn't quite qualify as a photojournalist, but his works did appear in the press. That is, particularly photographs that he did of buildings, not necessarily his own, certainly appeared. But I think I'm going to leave this for now and sort of turn to the subject at hand, which is photojournalism. Okay, well, this presentation addresses the development of photojournalism from a Jewish historical perspective that hasn't been enjoined very often. A disproportionate share of photojournalists, as well as editors, art editors, and picture agency heads were Jewish or of Jewish origins from 1918 to 1951. And in this discussion, and also previously elsewhere, I operate from the assumption that the novelty of photography allowed for the penetration of Jews, and Jews' tenuous position vis-a-vis respectability was a factor that influenced their outsized place in the history of photography. So I've got to say, one of the things that makes maybe my comments here a little bit different from some things that you would hear is I'm really not that interested in Jewish contributions or sort of famous Jewish photographers. What I'm really interested in is how the Jews who were involved, and I'd say they were overly involved, moved the field and how they changed it in different directions in ways that I think we could see actually have some kind of pattern. And the other thing that doesn't fit with the way people who would like to talk about it, what we'd call sort of a Whiggish way, oh, isn't everything wonderful? Aren't Jews great? Isn't everything that they do wonderful and sort of moving everything? Well, one of the reasons why Jews got into photography in the first place is because it was not considered very respectable. That is, for a long, long time, and we actually don't go all that far back in the history of photography, we only go back to the mid-19th century, but it wasn't considered the kind of thing that a proper, upstanding person did. So this wound up working to Jews' advantage. It worked to their advantage. It was something that was seen as marginal. It was often associated with things like pornography and forgery and all kinds of funny business, even though people really loved the photographs themselves. But photography itself was a strange process. Yet another thing these days, when actually sometimes people tell me, why are you talking about this? It's so easy to take a photograph. Or you just take it and you keep the good one, and I want to throw tables and chairs at them. Because there is so little appreciation for what it meant to take a good portrait or even a good photograph. So these people I'm going to be talking about were, for the most part, extremely talented individuals who had, I'd say, influence in rather interesting ways, but part of the reason why they were able to do what they did was that the whole field was kind of not quite proper, and they are actually the ones who helped turn it into something that would be regarded as respectable, or even by the time we get to the end, elegant. The kind of thing that people would want to do or claim that they would do. I would even say I've met many, many people who have told me that it's only very late in life that they were told about relatives of theirs who were photographers, and they find this very mysterious. Well, the reason why they didn't hear, at least in a number of cases, is because this isn't something that people took as a claim to fame. That is, it could be a decent living, it's definitely a nice thing to do, depending on where you are, But again, I think this problem of respectability in it is really quite central. Okay, one of the things I want to say from the very beginning is that a lot of the work that's done talks about the political nature or an ideological nature of photography. And a lot of it is connected to politics. And there is a fair amount of this. And one of the people I'm showing here, Giselle or Giza Lefroy, very clearly saw herself as someone who will be capturing a political reality and using the kind of work that she's doing for political purposes. But one of the things I want to look at is the fact that hits us over the head as historians is that most people are photographers to make a living. That is, they do it to earn their daily bread. And it might not be all that exciting to think about it in this way, but it's an important part of history, it's an important part of Jewish history, and I think that it means we have to look a little bit more closely at the meaning of photography as a business and why it was attractive as a business in the way it was and what the connections are between the way people had to operate as photographers and what they actually did in the world. So again, Giselle Freund is kind of an exception to the rule. Interestingly, the other picture I show here is somebody who the academics know very well, Walter Benjamin. She actually took this portrait of Walter Benjamin in Kodachrome, which is at different times sort of much disparaged by people in photography, in the photography world, for being this very popular product of Eastman Kodak Company. Kodachrome is especially near and dear to my heart. It was created by two young men named Leopold Godowski and Leopold Manis, who were the sons of classical musicians. They wound up being hired by Eastman Kodak Company in Rochester, New York, and really came up with Kodachrome after being supported in the beginning from a number of rather interesting figures, including some people from the Warburg family. But the reason why I have Walter Benjamin here, and I've got to say I have a lot of problems with some of his writing on photography, but the reason why he is used and why the name comes up over and over and over again in academic articles and talks is because he was one of the first people to say that there is a deep and complicated cultural significance to photography and that historians and critics need to pay careful attention to it and discuss it in serious ways. And I think that of all of the things he said, and he really didn't even know that much about it. A lot of the things he said was really rather wacky. And I'll tell you how this kind of occurred to me in this way. I was sitting at a conference at the University of Rome, which was wonderful, on the history of photography, listening to paper after paper, and my Italian isn't so great. And I thought, you know, I'm wondering if it wasn't for Walter Benjamin and Susan Sontag and Alfred Stieglitz and Siegfried Krakauer, if we would be sitting in this room and all these people would be talking about photography. That is, if not for these theorists on it, maybe we would treat cameras like refrigerators. That is, as academics, we don't go to very many conferences on like the history of the design of refrigerators or toasters or things like that, you know, useful things. Photography has come out to be very different, and I think Benjamin, the kind of people who have written about it, are part of the story. Okay, one of the main people I want to talk about who isn't mentioned very often, and if you do know him, it's all to your credit, that is Eric Salomon, I think changed photojournalism forever. Eric Salomon, in a lot of ways, was a very typical German-Jewish story that his father had been fairly well off. He wound up being ruined in the economic catastrophes following the First World War. He'd been trained as a lawyer, and then he found he sort of had to make a living, had to make a living. So he discovered almost by accident that he could make money selling photographs because of the kind of position that he had had, actually going back to Eric Mendelssohn and the Mossies, working for the Mossy publishing business, because he was actually selling advertising and then sort of running around Germany to make sure that the stuff was put up onto billboards and, you know, that people were doing what they were supposed to do. And he came to the conclusion that he could do himself what he was paying other photographers to do. And he turned out to be, I would say, arguably one of the most significant photographers of all time, and also a really tragic story, which tells us an awful lot about the Holocaust. I would say that Eric Salomon was by far the leading photographer of his time, and he was still murdered in Auschwitz. That is, he had connections, he had money, he had friends all over the world, and it still could not get him out of Theresienstadt and then eventually Auschwitz. And I think sometimes, you know, we tend to focus on the people who are very prominent and say, gee, they tended to get out of Germany, they were protected. But the reason why we don't know of more famous people is because they were murdered and have not necessarily been given their due. Okay, in looking at this whole world of photojournalism, and I don't think I'm too biased to say this, but we're looking at a couple big publishing houses from Germany, that is mainly the Mosses and the Ullsteins, were very interested in the pictorial press and were doing things with magazines that other places just weren't doing. And then this wound up being imitated in other places. There were some, say, tremendous film magazines that came out of Germany in the time. Okay, well, what was it that Eric Salomon was doing that was different, that was from what other people were doing or what the standard practice was at the time? Let's say he was interested in a particular meeting and he couldn't get in. He would still take some rather interesting pictures. This was a state reception where he couldn't get in for the king of Egypt, seen from across the street from 1919. This was not normal. This was not the kind of photograph that would have appeared in a newspaper. We had a rather strange coalition government in my country for a while, which I think was a great failure in many ways. Here we have Stanley Baldwin and Ramsay MacDonald, also part of a coalition government. Again, you could see they're sort of listening, and they're probably both a little bit hard of hearing at this point, or they're trying to catch what's being said. Very, very different from what had usually been taken. This is generally considered some kind of candid photograph, as is this. This is Lady Despereau and Miss Eleanor Brom. Now, again, this is not the kind of society picture that one would have seen. Again, there were these sort of unguarded moments, but I want to be very clear about this. He wasn't a sneak. People knew he was around. People liked him. That is, he was welcomed by most of those in like very high circles. Again, the shots themselves, you can say, well, is it something that they would have liked or they would have preferred? But he really would not have been given the kind of access that he was. There was a kind of intimacy in the way that he worked. But some of the writing that's been done, it sort of makes him out to be like some kind of Svengali or sneak, and I think it just didn't work that way. That is, there was this mix between the intimacy and the kind of work that he was doing. There were some people who just did not want him up close, including the great conductor Toscanini, so he just took to chasing him around in a car and taking whatever he could take through a car window. Again, not considered a normal picture. Here we, though, I've got to say, Salomon liked to play with this idea of a hidden camera. So this was from one of the great publications of somebody I'll be talking about just a little while, Stefan Laurent. Here he shows that his camera is hidden in his bagpipe. That is, he was marching in some, you know, who knows what kind of parade, and he's figured out a way to blend in. And he always thought, if at all possible, he should blend in. Okay. Another point that I want to make is that, and this was actually first made by a photographer who's also a fairly good historian of photography, Tim Gadow, who lived quite a long life. He wound up moving to Palestine, eventually Israel. Also, a photojournalist in Germany, but one of the things he said is that Jews have been the court photographers of Europe. that is all over. And and I found this to be true in my own work, even much more wide-ranging. But one of the things that's interesting is it meant that the same people were taking photographs of aristocrats, of kings and queens and dukes, also were taking pictures of entertainers and artists. And this is partly how these worlds came together. This is a picture of Josephine Baker by Emil Bieber, again, same family from Hamburg. They also had other studios in Germany. Thankfully, the Biebers managed to get out. They were able to make it to South Africa eventually. Okay, well here, you probably recognize at least one of the people here. That is Marilyn Monroe, who is with Alfred Eisenstadt. And Alfred Eisenstadt specifically credits Eric Salomon as being one of the main influences in his life. And then the other one is a little bit of a trick. Do you know who the photographer is of the first cover of Life magazine? Not one of the usual suspects for something like Margaret Bourke White. Well, what is Margaret Bourke White doing here? Well, she was a very close friend of Eisenstadt and many of these other Jewish photographers, very much a part of their world. Margaret Bourke, the father of Margaret Bourke Weiss, was a man, White was actually Weiss, who comes from the same place I do, from Rochester, New York, who actually was an interesting figure in the history of photo technology. Margaret Bourke White had quite a tortured relationship with her own Jewish origins, and I think one of the ways that she struggled with it is the fact that her milieu was mainly Jewish. It really was mainly Jewish, but she sort of liked to present herself as sort of the counter to her group. Okay, I guess he's not quite my favorite person politically, but I actually think that Clint Eastwood's movie about the raising of the flag, Iwo Jima, is actually pretty good. And it's actually pretty good about the history of this important film and the photograph that that goes along with it from Joe Rosenthal. And then, of course, we have this famous image by Eisenstadt. But my main point is that I think it's not a coincidence that these iconic photographs, so many of these iconic photographs are taken by Jewish photographers, because that's who was working as photographers at the time. And as the work that I'm doing right now is on the United States Army Signal Corps, both photography and film, and I'm finding that in these groups, it was also sort of a startling number of Jews. And as far as Eisenstadt is concerned, he had a background somewhat similar to Salomon. That is, he did not sort of grow up wanting to be a photographer, but in just sort of adjusting himself in order to make a living, this is what he wound up doing. Well, how does this fit? How does this possibly fit? I want to just tell you a little story. I wrote this book called Jews and Photography in Britain. And one of the things that I wrote about initially in an early draft of the book was a controversy that arose in 2007. The BBC did one of these fly-on-the-wall documentaries, actually a production company working for the BBC, and they were going to show what the daily life of the monarchy is like. And in the run-up to the presentation of this show, one of the things that the commercials were revealing as the great teaser was supposedly this big fight between the Queen and the photographer Annie Leibovitz. That is, they showed them, you know, like yelling at each other and doing all kinds of like really terrible gestures, and the Queen was making faces, and then this stuff appeared in the press that, well, the Queen is a very difficult person, and what would you expect? You know, Annie Leibovitz, she's kind of a pornographer. She did Demi Moore, sort of nude and pregnant. They didn't say she's a Jewish lesbian, but, you know, they insinuated all kinds of nasty things about her morals and whatever else. And something interesting happened. Annie Leibovitz said, "What are you doing?" She said, "This is completely untrue. You know, or what you're presenting is completely untrue." And they said, go away, you know, who cares? And then the queen called and she said, what you are presenting is completely untrue. The head of the production company lost his job. The head of the BBC lost his job. What had actually happened? They got along so wonderfully well that the queen, now of course 90 years old, did things with Annie, who she describes as a friend of hers, that she almost never does with other people, or certainly never does with other people when there are other people around. She made faces, all kinds of faces. She took her crown, she lifted it up and down, she twirled around with her cape, she sort of stormed in and out, she went backwards, all kinds of crazy things. They both were doing sort of crazy things with each other, you know, cameras were rolling as they often do. But what this production company did was they took the huge amount of footage that they had and they sort of edited it in a very interesting way to make it look like there had been a very big fight between them. Okay, why am I talking about this? I think the real story, or one of the stories, there is a really bizarre history of the intimacy of the royal family and a succession of Jewish photographers. And one of the reasons why I'm showing this picture here, the Queen of England is the Queen of England. That means she kind of gets to do what she wants to do. And for her 90th birthday, she invited the people in the world she most wanted to have lunch with, Barack and Michelle Obama, because she's the Queen of England and she likes them a lot. She invited them for lunch. They came for lunch. She also got to pick any photographer in the world to do her official 90th birthday portraits. And who did she bring back? Which I think was really a strong statement. Annie Leibovitz, and here we have the queen and her daughter, and then this rather wonderful picture here of the queen and her great grandchildren. And here we have, I can't remember the name of the little girl who's holding the purse, but you can imagine, I mean, I'm sure we have a couple photographers here. What do you do when you have kids who are a little bit antsy? You give them something to do. I'm sure she said, why don't you hold the purse? You know, why don't you hold it? I mean, it's great, absolutely wonderful, because this is one of the great icons of the world. It is the Queen's purse. Okay. All right, I want to go back to say a little bit more about Helmut Gernsheim. Helmut Gernsheim, in a lot of respects, is the person who first sort of assigned significance to Eric Salomon and many of these other photojournalists, saying that what they're doing is not simply good photography or useful, but it really should be regarded as art and studied in the way that art is studied. So Helmut Gernsheim became really the first systematic historical collector of photography who tried to establish a museum in Britain and unfortunately was thwarted in that process. His collection is now split between the University of Texas, the Ransom Center at the University of Texas, and the Rees Engelhorn Museum in Mannheim, Germany. And I could say a lot of things about Gernsheim, but we really would not have the kind of appreciation that we have for photojournalism if not for Gernsheim. And one of the figures he noticed immediately was Eric Salomon. Okay, another point that I want to make, which I think is really, really important. I have a colleague at the University of Colorado, David Schneer, who around the same time I was working on Jews and photography, was working on Jews in the Soviet Union. And his work materialized as a book called Through Soviet Jewish Eyes, Photography, War, and the Holocaust, because he realized, sort of similar to what I found in my own work, that the vast majority of photographers in the Soviet Union were Jews. And this actually meant something in the way that photojournalism was played out and different subjects were presented. Okay. One of the figures I do want to spend a little bit of time on is Robert Capa, and I won't go into very much detail, but has people here heard of Robert Capa? all heard of Robert? Okay. Was really another interesting figure who did not, say, wake up and say he wanted to be a photographer. He's actually a very bright man. He had wanted to be either an academic or an investigative journalist. He had actually studied politics, but in trying to sort of figure out what he was going to do with his life, he wound up learning photography, and there are a couple people who have sort of taken credit for teaching him photography, but actually it was most likely one of his women friends, Esther Bencio, who was actually quite a good photographer in her own right. Then also, there's an awful lot that's said about these Hungarians, but in photography, when there are a number of them, but in his own work, let's just say that Bob Kappa talks much more about himself as a Jew than as a Hungarian. And I think that in terms of how his career progressed, sort of the Jewish part is really quite significant, and my colleague David Schneer gets this quite right. I should also say in the very beginning that Robert Kappa was not Robert Kappa. He was born Andre Friedman, and actually his partner, Gerda Taro, is the person who came up with the idea of the two of them, that is both really talented photographers working at the time covering the Spanish Civil War, that they would create a fictional character, an American photographer named Bob Kappa, and it was kind of a takeoff on the director Frank Capra. And initially, this was sort of the edifice in front of their work. But then eventually, of course, she wound up being killed in the Spanish Civil War, and he wound up taking on this identity of Robert or Bob Kappa. But I think the most important thing about him is that he's a Berkowitz, that is, his mother was a Berkowitz. And this is actually not a throwaway. His mother was really the great sort of Jewish mother figure of all of the photojournalists at the time. That is, everyone knew about his mother. And not only that, even, say, you needed a shirt, or you needed some money, or you needed some help in whatever way. And you have to remember, this was a much more tenuous kind of living. It was really Bob Kappa's mother who kept things together in terms of the cohort of photojournalism, not just Jews, but non-Jews, but just all kinds of things about it. When he was killed in a terrible accident in Indochina, that is sort of the outpouring for his mother was really incredible. Again, he also, though, regarded Salomon as one of his great idols, and this comes up over and over and over and over again. Okay, another figure I want to say a little bit about is Stéphane Laurent. Stéphane Laurent is really one of the people who helped bring Robert Kappa and Eric Salomon to the much greater attention of the world. And he was a magazine editor. He was born in Budapest. He had worked in a number of places, including Munich. He had been a film magazine editor. He eventually got into big trouble in Nazi Germany. He was imprisoned by Hitler almost immediately. He did end up getting out. He escaped to Britain. He wrote a book called "I Was Hitler's Prisoner," which was quite a large success. And I think that Stéphane Laurent really helped define modern magazines, modern pictorial magazines. And there's something of a reversal when we think about Life magazine. You can find it in a number of places. That picture post of Stéphane Laurent was modeled after Life magazine. It's completely the other way around. Henry Luce actually knew Laurent well. He actually asked for complete sets of Laurent's work, and I think it's not that hard to prove what came first and who was modeling things in terms of the history of Life magazine. Like, the original Life was supposed to be sort of an experiment, but it was an experiment that stuck because it worked rather well. Okay, what I'm showing here is one of the big volumes, and unfortunately it's still not translated into English. This is sort of the major work of Helmut Gernsheim, where you could probably find, you know, because I'm very biased, but it's probably the best thing that one can find about photojournalism. But I want to play a little snippet, something that's not from photojournalism itself, but it's about sort of how photographs of a certain kind enter the wider world. And Helmut Gernsheim was a very interesting figure, discovered a lot of people who would become important photographers, and one of the people who he recognized as a serious and important photographer, although some of the work had been done before, was Lewis Carroll. And he had something of a problem in Britain because he wasn't quite sure how he was going to be received as a refugee in dealing with these photographs of Lewis Carroll, and also you have this little problem of photographs of children, and you know there wasn't quite the sensitivity there is now of what might have been the relationship between Carroll and these children. The point is that Gernsheim made it very clear that he would have to approach another refugee in order to publish the kind of book and photographs that he was going to publish, because he was, at that time, you could say, well, foreigner, it could mean anything. No, that's not true. At that time, foreigner, 99% of the time in British society, meant Jew. It was basically a euphemism for Jew in this particular context. So what we have is sort of this world of Jews among themselves in many ways, but they're not doing this as Jews. They're doing this in terms of what they're producing for the wider culture. But this very rarely would be talked about in any specific way. Okay, this is one of the earlier books of Helmut Gernsheim, and this is actually something that now we just take for granted. I was at a wonderful exhibition at what used to be the Whitney, now the Whitney Breuer, of these really tremendous architectural photographs. Well, you know what? The idea that a photograph of a building could be a work of art, or that the photograph of a sculpture could be a work of art in itself, is something that's relatively new. And Gernsheim is one of the people who did it, and he also put the stuff in magazines. It wound up being published in magazines as never before. Okay, you could say, well, didn't this stuff exist? Didn't it exist? What made it different under Stéphane Laurent was that it was much, much more widely accessible than it had ever been. That is, he managed to do it at a way that he would sell his publications at such a low price that they were affordable by almost anyone, which was dramatically different. Okay, just last couple of points that I want to make. In this wonderful novel by Galsworthy, The Forsyte Saga, you have a photographer who appears, and he's not even significant enough to have a name. He's just referred to as a camera, just the camera. So this is really where we start with in photojournalism. And this line from Hannon Swaffer, who is quite an important critic, he says, in those early years, the press photographer was regarded as an animal, almost beneath contempt. I mean, almost like much worse than, say, stereotypes about paparazzi. A figure who I've dealt with in depth is James Jarchet, who is the grandfather of someone who probably many people here know, that is the actor, or the grandfather of the actor David Suchet, and his own father had been a studio photographer. And again, he too looked to Eric Salomon as a great influence, specifically citing these particular pictures as among the most important ones of his life. But last couple of points I want to make. What difference did it make historically? What difference did it make? I actually think in some ways it did make a difference. The kind of work that Salomon and his son Peter Hunter did worked in a way to normalize Jews and Jewish politics. And they saw themselves as acting against a kind of racism in the Nazi world. And here we have Chaim Weizmann, who is presented, again, as a sort of dignified political figure at a political meeting. Here we have Lord Rothschild at a political meeting. This last, I'll go through rather quickly, this is Stefan Laurent, who was not only interested in doing his work, but actually even revealing how it was that he did the kind of work that he did, and jumping to post-war Europe. These are a couple of images from a photographer not so well known, now named Shim, or David Seymour, one of the closest friends and colleagues of Robert Capa, by far his best friend, again, Jewish DPs, photographed in other places. I also would make the case, as someone who's written about the history of the Zionist movement, that the kind of work that was done by Capa and by Shim wound up being far more important for the history of the Zionist movement and the emergence of the State of Israel than all of the so-called Zionist photographers put together. And part of the reason is that their photographs were not quite the same airbrushed quality as what was coming out from the official canon of Zionism, much more indefinite, much more dusty, much more sweaty and rugged and ill-defined. Show you this compared to this, sort of your typical Zionist stock image. And it really wasn't appreciated what people were bringing to the Zionist project at that time. And we could say just a general normalization of the Jewish world. These are Jews in the East End of London, near where I live now. Again, normal people. And this is one of the people taking them, Gertie Deutsch, who wound up being married to the successor to Stefan Laurent. I didn't plan to do this today. I've been doing this for a long time. These are boys who came on the Kinder transport. Now, one can say lots of good and bad things about Britain, but one of the things they did in the wake of Kristallnacht, that is the Night of the Broken Glass, or Nights of the Broken Glass of November 9th and 10th, 1938, is as a society, and this is not just Jews, this is actually mainly non-Jews who are major figures for this, they came to the conclusion that they should take in Jewish children from Germany, and they took in around 10,000 unaccompanied minors. Now, it's complicated, at least 2,500 did not consider themselves Jews, although the Nazis considered them Jews. They would not have considered themselves Jews. They were Christians. That means that there were around 7,500 who were brought in. I'd say that this kind of reception that they received in the press actually had something to do with the success of the operation. They were very explicit that they would not sort of buy this kind of ideology. All right, let me also say that Stefan Laurent did some other interesting things with his publications. Here we have a Dr. Goebbels in his home under someone else. And we have the monkey and her young. And then very interesting picture from the Keystone Press of Jews versus Baiters. That is Jews on their way to a demonstration. On their way to a demonstration. This is not in a Jewish publication. And here we have Baiters in the foreground, Streichler and Germany, they call German anti-Semite number one. Almost everyone has heard of Hartfield or Hartsfeld and these kind of photo montages. This was actually first brought to public notice by Stefan Laurent, as was really Robert Capa, much more than anything else. And I just want to show a couple other things. Last thing I want to say about Capa, he's actually written a very interesting autobiography called Slightly Out of Focus, which is much more serious than people give credit for. He's now the subject of two huge controversies, which I find disturbing. That is, two of his most famous photographs are regarded as having been staged. And there are sort of raging controversies on the internet, which basically allege that Capa is a fake, and that these photographs aren't actually what he said they were. And the first one is a falling soldier, and I'll be happy to talk about it in the question period. I think it makes no sense at all, the kinds of things people are saying. Capa's talked about this quite explicitly. And then his photographs from D-Day, that is, he was the single photographer who actually went in with the first wave of troops in D-Day, and now there's this crazy controversy about whether he was lying or not, about how long he was actually in the water and how many pictures he took, and that he couldn't have taken as many as he took. But he took our most extraordinary photographs of the D-Day landing. There was really nothing like it. And he, of course, had been one of the great photographers of the Spanish Civil War. But one of the things that Laurent liked to do, and why he used these people so well, was in his form of what he called juxtapositions, and he would do this for humorous effect. But one that I want to point out, and maybe I think I'll leave it here, this will be the last thing I'll talk about. This is Ernest Hemingway. Now, this is not a very attractive or complimentary picture of Ernest Hemingway. This says, writer seeks material. This is a picture by Robert Capa. Ernest Hemingway, famous American novelist on the Spanish front. This says, writer has material. Noel Coward, famous English playwright, in his study. There is something that I would like to call something that I'm stealing this actually from someone else, sort of a Jewish Esperanto. That is, there are a way that besides, say, giving each other breaks and sort of helping them to work the way they were working, there was something of not quite a language, but ways that they dealt with each other. And I've got to say, one of the things that these Jewish photographers had in common was they loved to take Ernest Hemingway down a notch or two. So this is a very unusual picture of Hemingway, and boy, did Capa and Stéphane Laurent know exactly what they were doing, even though they were friendly with him. But it means that it was done, and it's a really interesting photograph. So, and I've got to say, I've looked around in lots of places. I really don't think that anyone was doing this kind of work at the time, or if they were, they were not doing in this. They weren't doing it in this kind of popular medium. And I think it is really a rather extraordinary story. Some very, very talented people. But one of the things that we have at bottom is that it was really not regarded as a going thing. That is, it was regarded as a rather strange way for a person to make a living, or what they were doing with their lives. And this particularly was the opening that Jews themselves exploited. Okay, and I think I'll leave it there. Thank you very much for listening.
Well, it's not too late. We've got a few minutes.
Sure.
Portable, so we can.
Sure.
Questions.
So you gave us a little tease on the Robert Capa controversy.
Yeah. Sure.
To elucidate.
Oh, okay. Let me just the first one. And this has been going on for a while, is about what is the nature of this photograph? And there was actually quite a bit written about it, but there is a scholar at the Basque University in Spain who's been trying to make the case that this was completely staged, or that it was not a soldier dying in battle, that Capa actually sort of, you know, posed him or had him falling. This is absolutely absurd. I mean, one of the reasons why I find this absolutely absurd is that he was in some ways a kind of lazy guy. And the idea of sort of staging something or setting something up, it really doesn't make sense. And also, his work habits were a mess. That is, I've gone through the notes of photographers who are so meticulous at frame by frame, they'll have like lines underneath things, so it's absolutely clear what they're taking, you know, with each frame. Capa would, at best, he would have like notes on wrappers from gum or cigarette paper or anything. If he had anything at all, he didn't remember where he was. He would just make stuff up about where he had been. It simply wasn't the way that he just was not terribly systematic. He was brilliant. And then at one point, he actually gave an interview about this photograph, and he said the way that it came out the way it was is he was with these troops. He was crazy. He really was crazy because he went into battle in a way that other photographers did not actually go into battle. The typical thing is that you sort of hold on, but he said he was with these soldiers and they were being fired on. And he himself, he said, I am a coward. He said, I ducked down. And what he did was he was ducked down and he held his camera up at what he thought was the action and he snapped it. And this is the picture that he got. And I think it's pretty believable. But everybody's like, but the human body does not quite work that way when it, you know, if they get shot or whatever. This to me is complete craziness. But even worse is the controversy about the D-Day photographs. It is, I must say, one of the reasons why these bother me so much is I think that part of the old stereotype of the sort of Jewish photographer is sleazebag and charlatan and trying to pull the wool over people's eyes has come back in this sort of quasi-academic discourse. And I'm particularly infuriated by this horrible garbage that people are repeating that Kappa's role in photographing D-Day could not have been what he said it was, that he was actually only out there very, very briefly, and he couldn't have taken a roll of films because what happened was he had shot, I don't know how many rolls of film, and a lot of them got ruined in a developing mishap, and there were people like, oh, but film, it just, you know, this just doesn't happen. I think this is crazy to say that it couldn't have happened, but the biggest problem I have with the main critic, who I won't even name because he would sue me, the worst thing that people do, say historians, what do we say to our students never do? You can never assume that people do what you do or that everyone works the same way. Not everyone, say when they take photos, rips the part of the film box off with a serial number and puts it in a dry, protected place so you will have it. And I'm going to say, wow, if you know, Robert Capa did this in the best of times, it would have been extraordinary. This is D-Day. You know, there are bodies around him. It's gasoline, it's oil. There are you know, dead bodies he's being shot at. He's in the water. I mean, this is absolutely incredible. To say that, oh, he should have had the presence of mind, and that means that he couldn't have shot the number of rolls of film that he shot, it's absolutely crazy.
Mm-hmm. Well, he's not the only one. I mean, there are several iconic pictures that have been attacked over the last couple of decades. And I'm thinking of the Civil War photograph that was either Matthew Brady or Alexander Gardner took a picture of the sniper.
Yeah.
That now it's claimed by the critics that this guy was dragged over there and his wife.
Well, the difference with this is I find that there's something of this is a terrible way to put it, but there's kind of a pattern with the way this is repeated,
yeah, well,
which I've got to say I hate. I'm not one of these people that's like see anti-Semitism everywhere, but there's something creepy about it to me, how this has sort of become part of the normal academic discourse, which also sort of reflects on him as a person. And so this sense of, you know, people being familiar with these individuals.
I think it could be part of taking an iconic figure down, whoever it is, you know, whether it's Matthew.
Okay.
Brady,
all right.
I mean, maybe there's some of that in there too.
All right. No. I'll definitely consider it. I'll definitely consider it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
When you're saying that it wasn't, you know, respectable, so, but was there something else? I mean, they could have gotten into a lot of careers, which they did. So I'm looking for something else.
Well, there were other things about that is, there are a lot of things that sort of come together in this particular area, and it actually was a way to get into journalism itself. That is, say for Kappa, this is what he actually wanted to be. This is a sort of highbrow journalist or academic. This was one of the ways he thought that it might be possible. Also, I find lots and lots of connections to the art world. That is, there are loads of sort of generational flips of artists whose children become photographers and photographers whose children become artists. And I think that there is, although, you know, I'm talking about this as a livelihood, there's a very strong sensibility of it as sort of fulfilling some sort of aesthetic dimension, and I think that we do have to, you know, we do have to think about it in that way too. And then, so the classic argument is it what was portable? You know, this is the kind of thing you could do in different places, but studio photographers were certainly well settled. Mm-hmm.
I found a lot of your argument really interesting. One big question. And
sure. Uh-huh.
And I thought that was super interesting, but it feels to me like it's sort of in some ways comparing them to other kind of photographs that were circulating. This is a little bit about the Holocaust. There's sort of genres of photographs of Jews, and I'm wondering if there's ways in which their photography was explicitly trying to do something different from what other people were doing. So that's like the big question, and it's a big one. But the other one is just a comment, and I was talking to Lainey quickly about this very recently. There's been a controversy about the iconic photograph of the New York sailor, with the claim being that that was not a voluntary embrace, that in fact I was wondering if you come across that. So
yeah, no, I've heard that one as well. But in terms of what they were doing with Jews, no, I mean they were, but the fact that they were treating Jews normally in sort of Jewish politics normally as part of the spectrum of politics, this is something that really wasn't practiced by everyone. That is to say, particularly, I showed this picture of one of the Lord Rothschilds from a meeting that, again, happened to be about refugees in the Friends meeting house. So this is something that was taken as a serious political activity that, according, say, to other papers or other photographers, you know, it's just not something that would be regarded as newsworthy. So I think that there's a certain point when photographers are able to make these kinds of decisions and not simply accepting assignments, where they will make some different choices than maybe some of their colleagues would otherwise make. And I think this was certainly true in the work of Salomon. But in terms of one of the things that he was doing that was different, and one of the things I've tried to argue is that I think in some ways they were a bridge from the world of still photography and film. That is, one of the things you see in a lot of the work of Salomon was people in motion. And this is something that really caught Stefan Laurent's attention. And he was also really interested in the storytelling aspect of that. Even if you have a single photograph, it's really great if you could sort of make it into some kind of story. And this is part of what he was doing with the juxtapositions as well. And again, I think, you know, I don't buy this thing that, oh, there's a Jewish eye in looking at things. But I think that in terms of selection and the way that things are framed in different ways things are framed, there are things that say these photographers did differently, and even Margaret Bourke White, than say other people they were working with. But then you have people like Cartier-Bresson, who was clearly very sympathetic to Jews throughout his life, and part of it was that who were his best friends? He absolutely loved Kappa and Chim, and he said, these are the people really make me go. And I'll just say one little thing about it. Beaumont Newall and his wife went to go visit Cartier-Bresson, who they regarded as the world's greatest photographer, in Paris. And they said, how can you work here? This place is completely crazy. You know, that Chim and Robert Kappa were there. And they said, you know, we regard you as really superior to anyone. You know that, oh, these guys are really good, but you're really, and he said, I completely disagree with you. He said, I think that they are much more brilliant than I am. And also, I couldn't be who I am without them. I get my energy from them. And he said, I can't imagine doing what I'm doing without doing it with them. And Nancy and Beaumont Newell were not, you know, they were the least anti-Semitic people of all time. I mean, but they really saw Cartier-Bresson as a, but it really helped them to think differently about this whole cohort and how these people worked, how they worked together. Sure.
Comment on the role of the Leica.
Oh, great. Oh, I have a PhD student who's wonderful named Frank Dabba Smith, who is a rabbi in Harrow in North London, who is in the process of completing a fabulous PhD about Ernst Leitz and the Leica Company during the Second World War, which is a very interesting history. In a lot of ways, Ernst Leitz was a good party man. On the other hand, he is responsible for saving at least 70 Jews. So, you know, Leica is not, they're not Jewish, but there was sort of a Jewish friendliness about them or Jewish support about them, which is very interesting. And a huge number of these people I've shown you were actually huge fans and users of Leica, so much so that they always wanted to be identified. But one of the, if we look at different things, there was never any kind of anti-German taint associated with Leica, sort of like Volkswagen or other German products. And is that something that really held firm all the way through? And it's a really interesting story, but I'd say please invite my my PhD student, Frank Dabba-Smith, and he'll tell you, be able to give you a really great and complicated history of Leica. And actually one of our former colleagues from here wrote very well on it. That is Eric Weitz. Wrote tremendously. Eric Weitz wrote really well on this in his book on Weimar culture.